Isaiah 43rd, chapter 18 through 25th verses. Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The wild animals will honor me, the jackals and the ostriches. For I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself, so that they may declare my praise. Yet you did not call upon me, O Jacob, but you have been weary of me, O Israel. You have not brought me your sheep for burnt offerings, or honored me with your sacrifices. I have not burdened you with offerings, or wearied you with frankincense. You have not bought me sweet cane with money, or satisfied me with the fat of your sacrifices, but you have burdened me with your sins. You have wearied me with your iniquities. I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and I will not remember your sins. God's word for God's people. You may be seated. The NIV version of the same text, I'm going to just read a little bit of it. Forget. The NRSV says, do not remember, but the NIV says, forget the former things. Something about that stronger to me. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? If I asked you right now to get up and find a new pew, how many of you would do that? I'd ask you, if I asked you to find a new pew, go sit where you know. See, I thought we'd have a small group today. So I thought this would work, but this won't work. It's too many people. But if I asked you, by raise of hands, how many might do it? Okay, a few would do it. Changing pews is one of the hardest things to do in the church culture. Not just at RPC, but at any church in America. People get into their seats, they're used to their seats, and don't you mess with my seat. I love the Lord, I'm saved and sanctified, but this is my seat. If a guest wants to come and sit in your row, generally you will stand up and let that guest go through, but don't mess with my seat. Moving to a new pew sounds a little trite and a little silly, and again, I didn't know we'd have so many people, and it's a wonderful, wonderful sight to see. But changing pews may just be one of the most valuable moves you could make, because it is an exercise in change. It may help you get a better understanding on today's text. And this text is an invitation from the prophet Isaiah to the people of Israel to move beyond the familiar and experience something new. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? Isaiah 43 is addressed to the community of exiles in Babylon. The prophet is preaching to people who are already in unfamiliar territory. They have been uprooted from the place where they were born, the place God had given them. Now, these are the descendants of the Israelites who crossed the Red Sea to escape captivity in Egypt. But now they are captive again, some 700 miles away from home. Exile is a frightening experience. Customs and routines are wiped away. Familiarity is replaced by uncertainty. Life is no longer what it used to be. These people are yearning for the good old days. Things have changed, and nobody really likes change. That's because change is difficult. Doesn't matter if it's a major change or a minor change, a physical change or an emotional change, it can leave us struggling, feeling out of joint. A move to a new house, a death, the loss of a job, good or bad, change forces us to realize the unpredictability of the world. You see, we want the world to just work like this. Every morning I get up, I go to Dunkin' Donuts, I have my coffee, I see the same garbage man, I see the same. We want things to work like that. But the world we live in is unpredictable. And that's why we struggle, because we really do want predictability. Now, Now, resistance to change is not necessarily bad, so I'm not going to say you got to change. As a matter of fact, resistance to change is natural. In some cases, it's even good because it's a means of self-preservation, self-protection. Our bodies have a natural power to fight change. There's this term called homeostasis. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but it's the tendency of a system, usually a biological system, to maintain stability. For instance, sweat, that's the body's built-in system to regulate the temperature in your body. The hotter you get, the more you sweat. It's a natural cooling system. It's something I seem to do very well when I'm up here in this pulpit. If I know I'm in good shape because of that. If our body temperature goes up or down too fast, it's not a good thing. Health experts warn us that extreme diets and exercise can cause physical problems because our bodies naturally fight drastic and fast change. You cannot go from not moving to trying to run 6 miles in a day. It's just not natural. But the change that the prophet Isaiah preaches about is good change. Change that should be welcomed, change that should be embraced, change that should be desired. It's good because it's God change. You see, good change is God change. That means it's regulated by God, it's controlled by God, and it's taken care of by God because God is a change agent. See, I'm doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I'm making a way in the desert and streams in the wasteland. That's one spectacular promise that God is making to these exiles in Babylon. God is going to cut a path through his people's wilderness experience. Now, the very nature of wilderness is that it has no roads. It has no marked routes. It's wild and uncultivated. In the bush, in the wilderness of South Sudan, the most important tool you could have was a machete so that you could hack your way through this bush, through the wilderness, because vines grow and trees grow and all kinds of stuff grow. And if you want to get through sometime and there's no path, they say you have to hack your way through. Now, the only problem with that is if you don't really have a big picture of where you're going, you can hack your way into a circle. You just keep on hacking and not go anywhere. But God says, I'm going to get you through this wilderness. I know where you're starting and I know where you're going. Then he says, I'll make streams. I'm going to make deserts in the wasteland. I don't know if you spend any time in the desert, but again, the other part of the geography in South Sudan, if you're not in the bush, you're in the desert. That's all they got. They have the bush and the desert. And if you're in the desert, you could die because there's no water there. You could die of thirst. Few forms of life can exist because there is no water. So here, God is promising the people in exile that he will supply whatever is lacking in their situation. Now, this exile in which the Israelites find themselves is not only physical. They are not only 700 miles away from home. There is something spiritually missing in their lives. And that's why he talks about this way through the wilderness and water in the wasteland. They are missing direction, the way through the wilderness, water. They are missing life. They are suffering because of their faithlessness to God. But as bad and bleak as that situation may be, the word of God is, I can change this. God is a change agent. That's what he's telling them. You know, God stepped into darkness and he changed it to light. He grabbed some dust and he made a man. God can take hold of any situation and change it. As a matter of fact, that's not just what God does. That is who God is. God is a change agent. Remember Jesus at that first miracle in the book of John? He goes to a wedding and the first thing he does, he changes water into wine. God can change anything. God can take hold of a church and change it. He can take hold of a life and change it. There is no situation that is outside of God's ability to change. He can change anything. But here's the catch, and this trips us up every time, tripped up the Israelites. God demands some change from us. God can change anything, but God demands some change from us. Romans 12:2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. There's always something we can do. Always. And this sermon that Isaiah is preaching to the exiles offers us a primer on the dynamics of change. The Israelites are in this predicament, as I said, because of their disobedience. Their exile is a result of their turning away from God. The whole of Isaiah, the whole book of Isaiah, is exhorting the people of Israel to turn back. Isaiah 29:13, the Lord says, "These people come near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me." So that's what he's been talking about all throughout this book. There are actually two books of Isaiah, Isaiah and Deutero-Isaiah. The first book is the judgment against the people, and that is from chapters 1 to chapters 40. And then the second book, 40 on, is the comfort. But he's saying, you need to come back to me. That's what God wants you to do. Your heart is far from me. You talk a mean game. You act like you're worshiping me. You build your temples. You give your tithes. You say all your, but you're not really doing it. It's just lip service. That's rebellion. That's disobedience. Now we say, well, that's just the way I do it. It's just, that's just my habit. I come to church. I don't think about this heart thing. But God wants your heart to be open. He wants your heart to be open. Now, I preach often about the heart, and I know you sit there and say, why is she always talking about the heart? Well, the Bible talks a lot about the heart. The heart is mentioned at some thousand, more than 1,000 times throughout the Bible. While we think of the heart as the center of physical activity, that blood that's pumping in that chest and protected by the rib cage, the Bible says, okay, that's part of it, but it really goes deeper and broader. The heart is the center of our hidden emotional, intellectual, moral activity. The heart is the inner man, Paul says. It's what you really are inside, and it's generally hidden from the world. But God knows your heart. That's the whole point here. Samuel said, we are concerned with the outside person, but God looks at the heart. Now, we think of the heart as something you send on Valentine's Day. Or, you know, when you were a child, you say, I cross my heart and hope to die. But that's not the heart that God is talking about. He's talking about something deeper, something that really identifies who you are to God. The heart is our biggest moral and spiritual muscle. And it's also our greatest challenge. Jesus said, from within, out of men's hearts, come the evil thoughts. You see, because you don't know what's in my heart, I can just keep my stuff down in there. And I can smile in your face and be really kind of cursing you in my heart. You don't know. The heart is deceitful above all things. That's what Jeremiah reminds us. We think we know our own heart, but we really don't. Folly is found up in the heart of a child. Proverbs says that. So it is the Holy Spirit that gives us this new heart. God will give you a new heart through faith that purifies it. That's why my favorite scripture, I always say, create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew in me the right spirit. It begins in the heart. Sometimes I don't even know my own heart. So I have to always ask God to clean up and restore your heart. Because if your heart is open to God, you're going to be all right. But our challenge, like the challenge of the Israelites, and I truly believe this is the human condition, too many of us have hearts that are exiled.
Help us, help us.
The exiled heart. Our hearts have been cut. They've been damaged. They've been manipulated, used, abused, broken, twisted, hardened, shifted away from God. Our hearts, our inner selves. We say, oh no, no, I know what's going on. I'm a Christian. No, but your heart, where's your heart? Let's go back to the text. Isaiah says, forget the former things, don't dwell on the past. So the question is, how does this impact our hearts? What does this mean? How does this help us get back to God? How does this help us get out of exile? couple of things I have for you, just a couple of things, because this won't be long. God is not saying, forget me. It is always productive to remember God, to remember what God has done and where we were when God stepped in. But it may not be productive to dwell on life without God. You see, we weigh our hearts down with many unnecessary burdens. It is better to forget about that part of the past because you have to live in the present. The past can teach you, the past can illustrate for you, but it must not bind you. It must not hold you back or hold you down. You can keep your mind so focused on the past that you might miss out on a future blessing. Think about that. If you know, Boston is a city of great history, and we love to talk about our past, and that's fine. That's wonderful. But you really can't live in the past. You have to let things go. And I'll give you a good example. I talk about neighborhood schools when I go to community meetings, and people get really mad at me because the history of Boston is that neighborhood schools was a code word for segregation. That was a code word for inferior schools. But my contention is, I got you. That was horrible, but we still need to fix our neighborhood schools. We still need to get this stuff. That's why we're working on the Dearborn. Not because of the past, because of the future. I'm not saying that we should forget that they were bad and everything, but we got to let go of some of that stuff so we can move to the future. That's what God is saying here. He's saying forget about the past. T.D. Jakes puts it this way. If you hold too tight to history, you may lose your destiny. You can't hold on. I'm not saying that you forget the person or you forget the love that you had. But somehow you have to disconnect with the pain. God always has greater things in store. That is how God operates out of his love and his mercy. So that's the second key. The reason we can forget about the past is because we serve a merciful God. God is a God of grace. He says in verse 25, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. We hold on to all the stuff we did bad, the stuff that was done bad to us. We hold on a lot to our sins. Guilt is one of our biggest problems. And I'm not just talking about folks in Roxbury. I'm talking about the human condition. I'm guilty about what I did, so sometimes I try you for my own guilt. I treat you bad because of what I did. We need to let go of some of that stuff. Because God says, I'm going to let it go. I forgive you. And this is the part I like. He says, I blot out your transgressions for my own sake. God forgives us not because we're worth forgiving, not because we've done our penance and it's all good. He forgives us because that's the nature of God. It's grace. God's mercy is what keeps us moving forward. Israel could face in exile, we can face in our pain a future because of God's grace. He is revealed in the past, but God is always more than the past reveals. This is how God's mercy works. It pulls you forward. Future grace, future grace. Grace is not just what God has done for us. Grace is God's promise. That's what he's telling these people in exile. It always begins right now and moves us ahead. Forget about the past. Don't dwell on former things. Can't you see I'm doing a new thing? Now, if we decided to memorize this text, and I'm always saying that we should memorize scripture, if we chose this as our memory scripture, think how much you could accomplish because you are no longer wasting your energy on the guilt of the past. RPC is about to become involved again in trauma work in this community. I don't know if you've heard about all the talk of trauma, but we know we live in a community filled with wounded people. That's what you see in this community. People have been hurt and have not been able to heal. A lot of our problems in this neighborhood are the inability to let go of pain. Now, I'm not saying you got to let go of the memory of the situation, but to let go of the pain. We hold on to unforgiveness. We hold on to injustices. We hold on to anger. James Baldwin once wrote that one of the reasons people cling to their hate so stubbornly is because they sense that once the hate is gone, you're going to have to deal with the pain. And so we have a traumatized people. We self-medicate because of trauma. We abuse our loved ones because of the trauma on us. And it's almost like nobody believes God when God says, I can make a way through that wilderness for you. I can get water in that desert. There is nothing that you have been through that I can't heal. I'm God. We have to put our trauma out there and ask God to heal it. If we learn to let go of the past, what then will replace it? This question is at the heart of this text, and this is the question that confronts the 21st century church. We are called to serve people in exile. In order to do that, in order for us to effectively serve all these people whose hearts are in exile, the church has to get out of exile as well. Now that's a hard one. The church is also in exile. We're in our own exile. Like the community we serve, we are cut off from what we used to be and scared of where we're headed. Now, I'm not just talking about Roxbury Presbyterian Church. Matter of fact, I'm not sure I'm talking about this church at all, but I know that many churches are stuck in exile, cut off from where you were and don't know where to go. There's a great deal of conflict in the church today. And I'm not talking about traditional music versus contemporary music. I'm not talking about older people versus young people. That the issue of changing the pews is about seeing something different. It's slight, but it's profound. The point is, we do not necessarily have to change the church. What we need to do is change what we see as the church. God wants us to see beyond the obvious. God wants us to see what He is creating anew. It's very easy to look at RPC only as a small church, struggling to attract new members. That's a lot of attention we pay to that. That would keep us, however, if we kept looking only at that, that would keep us focused on one little direction. What do we do to fill the seats? I'm not sure that's what God wants us to look at. Our faith is renewed and restored if we see differently. You see, if you're only looking from your natural eyes, you're only going to see physical things. You have to look from your heart. Paul writes in the letter to the Ephesians 1:18, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which God has called you. So see, we're back to the heart, this important part, this center of who we are. The Greek word to know is not that different from the Hebrew word to see. It suggests a fullness of knowledge. God's plan is that we fully know the hope to which we are called through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now that works in us both individually and it works in us as the body of Christ. Changing pews symbolizes a shift of our perception of who we are in this body, of how we relate to each other, of what we give. I'm gonna sit next to a person I don't know. I'm gonna talk to somebody I don't usually talk to. That shows an opening of our hearts, you see. I have perceived this shift of hearts already in this church. I've noticed some extraordinary changes of heart in this body. My heart has changed, and I believe that's how God works. God is doing a new thing in RPC already. He's changing hearts. Now, whether the pews get filled up, that'll just be the icing on the cake. But the real point of being here is to have our hearts open to God so that we can be the hope God has called us to be. We're getting a deeper understanding of this continual source of hope through Jesus Christ that empowers us to live and work in a community. Now here's the important part. We gotta be the hope because we live in a community where hopelessness is the norm. You can't find hope at the liquor store. I'm gonna tell you, it's not there. Save-A-Lot is not selling hope. There's no hope on the T-line. We are the hope. But if we don't have no hope, we can't give no hope. So God says, if you open your heart, I'll be the hope. That's what he's talking about. But you can't have no exiled heart and expect it to work. You have to shift your heart to God. Because if you have a different way of seeing, you see, if you have a different way of seeing, you have a different way of being. What you become starts with what you see. And God said, can you not perceive it? Can you not see it? I'm doing a new thing. It's all around. It's springing up all over you. Roxbury Presbyterian Church once housed the largest AA community in the city. We don't want to dismiss that. That was a powerful and creative expression of the life of Jesus in this community. We need to build on that through the eyes of our heart. We want to conceive of new ways to love Jesus, to glorify God, to serve God's exiled hearts. So we're praying and thinking about formally setting up a community trauma center through the Social Impact Center. Now, this is no different from what we're always doing. The church, by the nature of God, is a trauma center. But we're going to work with new partners and set up a structure so that people will know if you are suffering from a broken heart, you can come here. That's all it is. We're going to call it something new with a slight repositioning and uttering new words and making new gestures. We acknowledge and become part of God's fresh spiritual activity in the world. Our hearts remain open, and we model open hearts to people we serve. Because you see, and this is all the message is, you think your heart can't be mended, but it can. You think it's wounded too deep to be healed, but you just don't know my Jesus. You think that cold hearts cannot be renewed and restored, but God can do anything. You think crushed hearts cannot pump vitality and life again, but I'm here to tell you that's God. God can do it. Exiled hearts can return home. That's God's plan. God is going to make a way in the desert because that's what God does. God is going to make rivers in the wasteland because that's who God is. We just need to see it with the eyes of our hearts. Let us pray.